Hello, and welcome to Looking to Score, the podcast where we geek out about movie music, composers, and everything else in between. I'm Breanne Brennan, and joining me, as always, is writer, podcaster, soldier, spy, Brett Blake. How are you?
I'm terrific.
Are you? Are you really?
I think I am, yes, especially after that introduction.
All right. Well, that's good. Today, we are coming to you with an introduction to our second season with a bonus episode. And we'll be talking about our favorite picks, our best of 2021.
That's right.
Now, what are your overall thoughts of the score landscape for last year?
What are my overall thoughts? I don't have a particularly high opinion of a lot of the scores that came out in this past year, honestly. It feels like, you know, some of the big ones that I was hoping were going to deliver did deliver. And some scores that were for films that were really sort of indie and under the radar also delivered. But the sort of the middle ground in between, I don't feel like there was a lot that was particularly noteworthy.
Yeah, I'm kind of in the same boat. I was slightly underwhelmed this past year with the amount of movies that were released compared to, you know, 2020.
Right.
Which you would think there wouldn't have been that much. But no score really knocked me off my feet this year. I mean, aside from my top pick, more or less. Mm-hmm. When I was compiling my best of 21 playlist for scores throughout the year, I found myself, you know, just picking one track here and there to add to it. And
yeah,
you know, those single tracks were probably the best of the year for some scores. And I'll kind of touch on them in my honorable mentions category.
Sure.
As we get going.
Yeah. I mean, to me, I feel pretty good. I mean, I feel very good about the top five that I'm going to discuss. In terms of like honorable mentions, which, you know, we'll get to, I felt like if I included any more than I ended up including, it would have been a reach. Like I would have genuinely been sort of just including things to include things that I didn't feel strongly about. So there was a lot of that this year. There was a lot of serviceable scoring, scores that work fine for the film, didn't detract from the film, didn't distract, but there wasn't a ton that I felt like either elevated the film or it could exist on their own outside the film as something that I would want to sit down and listen to.
Yeah. And I found myself not really like, if I go through my Spotify albums, for example, there's probably like two or three that I go back and listen to in full.
Right.
But that's about it. So why don't we jump into our honorable mentions?
Sure.
From this past year. What do you have?
Really only two. And one of them you're going to be talking about later on your best of list, and that's The Green Knight from Daniel Hart. So I won't say a whole lot about it here other than I think it fits the movie very, very well. And that's all I'll say at this point. Number two on my honorable mentions is Fear Street Part 2, 1978 from Marco Beltrami and Brandon Roberts, which is a really affectionate homage to Jerry Goldsmith's Omen trilogy scores. Like at some points it's like the Omen, you know, on crack. I mean, it's really going all the way, lots of choral work, lots of slashing strings, lots of big brass statements, just a very entertaining big horror score.
Yeah, choral music seemed to be in this past year.
Yeah.
There were a lot of instances of it.
Yep.
So I could have thrown a whole bunch more on my honorable mentions, but I've got a few here. Raya and the Last Dragon by James Newton Howard. There were some good tracks in there, but not fully bringing the kettle to a boil, per se. The Courier by Abel Korsnowski, which was, again, a serviceable score from him. An under-the-radar score called Finders of the Lost Yacht by Panu Altio, which kind of reminded me a lot of, you know, early Spielberg movies. A very, very upbeat kind of orchestrations with that. And I know you're going to be talking about this later, but Dune was an honorable mention for me. I thought it was a great score. I wanted more of a theme to it, though.
Mm.
Next is Don't Look Up by Nicholas Britell, which just got an Oscar nomination. Very jazzy, upbeat flavor to that one. And then Nightmare Alley by Nathan Johnson, which is a very subtle noir score that doesn't really call attention to its noirness. Johnson kind of leans heavily on the piano as the star instrument here rather than, you know, a cliche solo trumpet that we hear a lot from noir scores. So definitely give those a listen.
I will do that. Some of these were completely new to me, so I'll be doing a little more investigation after this.
Excellent. Now getting into our best of 21. We've just boiled it down to 5 top picks here. So why don't you start us off with your 5th pick?
My number 5.
Yes.
My number 5 is Candyman by Robert Aiki Aubrey Lowe. And this is one of those where it's not a great movie. And I would even probably hear arguments that it's not even a good movie. But it is a very good score. It's a pretty effective spiritual heir to Philip Glass's work on the original Candyman film. And this score incorporates some of the very repetitive kind of cyclical construction of the motifs that Glass uses in his music. And you get a good sample of this in the cue called The Suite. And Lowe also, though, adds a lot of new musical ideas here, including some electronically processed, almost kind of sound effect type stuff that is very unnerving, which you can particularly hear in a track called Rows and Towers. You know, this is not an easy score to just sit down and listen to because it can be challenging at times, but the very dark atmosphere is something that I find works really well on me. So I enjoyed this one quite a bit.
Yeah, it's ultra sinister in a way. And going back to what you said about the like the electronic elements, you do get a feel of like buzzing bees.
Yes, it's almost like, you know, some kind of organic sound effect that has been processed to become very unnerving.
All right, my number five is another under the radar score by Dalibor Grubacevic, and it's from the movie The Match. You know, it's not a flashy score, but I love how much it sounds like an old-fashioned James Horner score. You have a lot of thematic elements, very sweeping orchestrations, and you can hear that in a track called Main Title. All right, what do you have?
My number four pick is for another one of these under-the-radar films, which is called Broadcast Signal Intrusion by Ben Lovett. And this is sort of the movie is kind of a horror noir fusion, and the score very much reflects that. This is a dark horror score, but heavily inflected with a very old-school prototypical noir flavor. You get the usage of trumpet in the opening titles, and that could be right at home in a straight detective story. And you've also got sort of unusual percussion elements that are peppered throughout that give a bit of a propulsiveness and the feeling kind of an investigation that is moving forward into more and more dangerous territory.
Mm-hmm. My number four pick is The Green Knight by Daniel Hart. I don't know if you feel this way, but Hart to me is kind of someone who doesn't really come with his own brand of score. He's always experimenting with something new. And I think he goes all out here. Mm-hmm. And he really embraces this unnerving medieval tone of the film with the use of an ethereal chorus and a Swedish keyed string instrument called the nickel harpa. And you can hear that in the track, I Promise You Will Not Come to Harm. And then he pretty much goes into experimental territory with some pulsating synth elements in One Year Hence. So it's really an eclectic score, and again, not so much an easy listen, but one that you can really appreciate for all the elements that come together within it.
And it almost, you know, listening to it divorced from the film, I mean, you might not necessarily know what the subject matter of this film is, but the music itself is pretty compelling stuff. And as you said, eclectic. I mean, there's a lot of influences that are sort of put in here, and not in a way that feels like he's ripping anything off. Mm-hmm. Like, it's a really effective sort of synthesis of a bunch of ideas.
Yeah.
All right. So my number three score of the year was already briefly mentioned, and that is Hans Zimmer's Dune. And, you know, I agree with what you said about, you know, sort of wanting more of a discernible theme to really sort of hang on to. And I get that. But purely in terms of the way the score is presented in the movie, and especially the way it was mixed for the cinematic experience, I think this is just a very impressive score. The score and the sound design together, you know, I've used the word overwhelming to describe it, and I think that's accurate. I stand by that, but I mean that in the very best way. And I think Zimmer did a very good job of creating this sense of epic and mysterious scale that fits the story of the film to a T. Going back and watching the David Lynch film, which also has some very good music in it, that score feels divorced from the film because the film is so aggressively strange. Mm-hmm. Whereas Zimmer's score here feels like he was working totally in concert with Denis Villeneuve as the director, and he had just had a complete handle on what the movie needed from its music in terms of a tonal atmosphere. And I think that's conveyed very, very well by Zimmer.
And I do look forward to what he's going to bring to part two.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, you know, to me, Dune was my favorite movie of the year last year, but even I concede that, you know, they have to stick the landing. I mean, the sequel has to deliver, or otherwise this will sort of be just a curiosity rather than, you know, an actual achievement. And there's enough stuff yet that they held back, presumably to use in the next movie, that I think Zimmer will have fun creating score for.
All right. My number three pick is Spider-Man No Way Home by Michael Giacchino. And I think, once again, he tops his previous Spider-Man entries with a score that just has a plentiful blend of melodic action pieces, which you can hear in the track Liberty Parlance, where the main theme is kind of bolstered by this backing chorus. He's able to create moments of sensitivity as well, which you can hear in the track Octogon, where the main theme is much more tender sounding. So it's really a nice blend of action and more sensitive pieces.
Yeah, I completely agree. And in fact, it's my number two. So let's slide right into that. I think this is Giacchino's best of his three Spider-Man scores. The amount of development and variation that he's able to sort of wring out of the actual main Spider-Man theme is very impressive to me. And particularly, you touched on the way he uses it in action sequences. I think it's a really exciting and versatile theme in that setting, especially when it's sort of interwoven with other thematic material. Like, there's a big set piece in the film that is Spider-Man and Doctor Strange fighting essentially over a supernatural trinket. And you can hear the way that Giacchino allows each theme to sort of bounce off each other, and sort of the interplay between the themes is really fun. And you hear that in the cue called Sling versus Bling. And on top of that, of course, he brings in still some new thematic material. And the best of the new themes is this sort of contemplative motif that sort of underlines Peter Parker's determination. And you hear it throughout the second half of the score, but sort of its most full presentation comes in a cue called spider baiting.
Moving on to number two. My number two pick is No Time to Die by Hans Zimmer.
Mm.
Now, I think with the handoff of the Bond scores from David Arnold to Thomas Newman and now to Zimmer, we've gotten a lot of unique sounds from both composers who have really just run with the Bond theme and made it their own.
Mm-hmm.
I think Zimmer's score is almost a throwback to the early John Barry scores, and you can kind of hear that in the track Matera. Now, I think you have something to say about this as well.
I do, yeah. This is my favorite score of the year. And basically, I think this is Zimmer going Bondian without ceasing to be Zimmer, if that makes any sense. You know, as you say, he draws on a bunch of the history of the Bond scores going all the way back to Barry while still putting his own stamp on it. And you can hear sort of how he applies his own style to the Bond style, particularly in the action music, which mm-hmm. is big, it's loud, it's full of the sort of wailing, blaring brass that John Barry really sort of made a fixture of the music for this score. But it's also full of personality too. And if you listen to the music for the Cuba sequence, which is my favorite section of the movie by far, and it may be the best section of film that Daniel Craig's Bond run has delivered for me so far. He brings in this Latin flair to this Cuba sequence that is just pure fun. I mean, it's the kind of thing you just have to smile as you're listening to it.
Thank you.
on top of that, one of the things that I always look for in a Bond score is how well is the theme song integrated into the actual score?
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes the composer will have actually worked on the song, so then they will naturally try to incorporate the song into the score. Sometimes the song is sort of farmed out to a third party and the composer really doesn't have much of a say, and then they might not use that song, the melody, in the actual score. But in this case, even though Zimmer didn't write the Billie Eilish song, he still freely uses the melody within the score, particularly during the second half, where it essentially becomes the main theme of the score. And Zimmer even brought Eilish in to do vocal work, which ends up being a really effective touch, sort of ties everything together. And you hear that most notably in the track called Home.
I have to say, I think the theme song, or Eilish's theme song, is a little underwhelming, but I love how it's used in orchestration format throughout the movie.
Yeah, it's got a very discernible melody that becomes memorable once you hear Zimmer sort of put it through its paces in the score.
All right, moving on to my number one pick. I have chosen The Electrical Life of Louis Wayne by Arthur Sharp. Now, it's probably not a surprise to you that I've chosen a quirky, theme-heavy score for my top pick, but I like how Sharp highlights some unusual instruments throughout this. There's the theremin and the musical saw, which really capture the eccentricities of the titular character. And that being said, the score plays with variations on the main theme, which you can hear in a more upbeat fashion in the track A Levity in Love. But what I think is arresting about how he uses the musical saw is that it's played in a way that is able to evoke melancholy, yet a tender emotional feel. And you can hear that in the track titled Electricity. Thank you. So do yourself a favor, give that a listen. I think it's a score that bears repeated listens, in my opinion.
Cool. Yeah, this is a new one to me. So it's going on the list for me to check out very shortly here.
Excellent.
I think we could maybe end with looking forward into the future for 2022, now that we're, you know, a month and change in it. Any high hopes, any scores or movies that you think could result in some interesting scores that you're looking forward to?
Oh, God. I don't know. What's coming out this year?
Well, to me, the big one that's got my interest is Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness. Because we've got Danny Elfman and Sam Raimi together again. And usually that results in something that's pretty entertaining to listen to. So that's definitely on my list. Giacchino's next Jurassic World score, we'll be getting that this summer. Then going out way to the end of the year, which this score hasn't even been recorded yet, but it was just reported in the news that it's going to be starting to record within the next month, which is John Williams' score for Steven Spielberg's film, The Fabelmans, which is sort of the semi-autobiographical thing that Spielberg has written, sort of based on his own experience as a young filmmaker. Hmm. And I don't know, I've got my fingers crossed this could finally be Williams's number 6 Oscar coming to him. If they play their cards right, if they construct the right narrative that the Academy would be interested in, because Williams is apparently under the impression that this is the final film he's doing for Spielberg.
Ooh.
So even though Spielberg has said, I don't think that's necessarily true, Williams has kind of said, I think this is going to be the last one. So hopefully that's going to result in him putting his all into it, which he always does. I mean, you know, Williams never phones it in. But so I'm looking forward to that. That'll be coming out in November.
Excellent. Well, we're glad you joined us for our opening episode. We hope you join us next week when we talk about Hans Zimmer. Gasp.
The man himself.
Indeed. We will see you then. Cheerio.
Take it easy.